This morning I'm going to be preaching about Jesus going out into the wilderness. I'm going to read here just this verse, and then I'm going to go to chapter 4 in Luke. This is in chapter 3. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also, being baptized, prayed, and the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in a bodily form like a dove upon him, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my son who has well pleased." You know, in another place up on the Mount Transfiguration, it said, "Jesus, my son who am well pleased." And you know, today people doubt, you know, was he really the Son of God? Well, I tell you, God said it. And you know, if God said it, and all the things he did, then he was. So, starting here in chapter 4, Luke, you know, I was reading through a lot of it, and I thought, well, I'm going to preach on something else. And I got up this morning and opened the Bible up, and it turned directly to Luke. I was in Matthew, but right here. And I thought, well, God, that's where you want me to. But I said, Heavenly Father, I ask, oh God, to help me today, God, and Lord, to say whatever needs to be said, oh God. And Lord, thank you for the word today, God. Bless the people, Lord, as they receive the word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. I tell you, we're not always going to be up on the mountaintop. Yeah. And you know, it's always been Satan's thing to get men to fall down and worship him. You know, he led a third of the angels out of heaven, rebelled against God. He tried to ascend higher than God, but you know, God said, nobody's going to ascend higher than I am. You know, but you know, he thought, well, I'll get them. You know, God made him, they say, the most beautiful angel out there. And you know, some way he got pride in him, and he thought, well, I can be bigger than God, more famous than God, and I can take the kingdom over, the kingdom of heaven, and all of this. But you know, it didn't happen that way. But he, you know, returned from Jordan, be led with the Spirit in the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And those, he did eat nothing, and also he didn't drink anything. Water. When they ended afterwards, he was hungry. You know, Satan is never going to come to us when we're part of, when we're up on the mountaintop praising God. You know,
right.
When we get down in the valley and down and out and discouraged, like the brother said, he's going to come and tell you, you know, God doesn't really care about you. Why I keep on keeping on for the Lord? You know, just give up. You wouldn't be going through all of these troubles, you know, if it wasn't for that, you know. But I tell you today, we may not be up on the mountaintop all the time, but I tell you, thinking there about Moses, you know, he had the best of things over there when he was in Egypt. And, you know, God, you know, was going to use him. But, you know, God could not use him till he got the world out of him. And it took 40 years being in the backside of the desert. And he cried out to God. God had to mold him and shape him into his will and break that old proud spirit that he had there of the Egyptians raised up by the king's palace. And I had to get it out of him. And that's today, I tell you, it's good sometimes to go to the wilderness.
I
tell you, when we, he puts us on our knees, praise God, and we get down and we pray and we cry out to God and we say, God, I can't make it another mile. I can't go on, but we pray, and God, you know, he gives us that power to come on and keep on for another day. Praise God, we live day by day, praise God. We may not be up next week, but I tell you, God will send somebody your way, and I tell you to pray with you and whatever, or you can get in the Word of God and open up and say, God, they went through this, and I'm going through it, God.
Come on, you said
you're no respecter of persons, and God, I'm taking you for your word, and God, you're going to bring me through it.
Amen.
We think we had problems. Look at Job. He went through more than any man would go through. Lost everything. Lost his family. Lost all of his wealth. And the theologians say, well, he probably went through that about 8 months through the sickness and the boils and all of this. And you know, his wife said, "Oh, Job, cuss God and die. Get out of your misery." And he said, "You know, you talk like a foolish woman." He said, "Even though the skin worm will eat me up, I know my Redeemer liveth."
Hallelujah.
I know there's going to be a resurrection.
Yes.
I know that there's going to be a place one day I will come out of this old grave and I'll be walking down the streets of gold.
Amen.
Praise God. And I was thinking about Apostle Paul. They say he ran up there to the chop block because he had a glimpse of heaven. He knew what heaven was like.
Yes.
He thought, "You know, my labor's over down here." He said, "You know, I fought a good fight. I have fought and I have won the battle." Praise God. You know, we go through a battle when our time gets ready. You know, I'd like God to say, "My son, you have fought a good fight. You have carried on the faith. You have been a good testimony for me. And now welcome in." I tell you, I got loved ones up there, and they're waiting for me.
On,
praise God. One day we'll walk down those streets to go. And I tell you today, we can wait. We can go through it. Whatever we face, brother, we can go through it. You know, like the Holy Ghost, God will comfort us in the time of sorrow.
Yes, He will, brother.
And in the time of need, He'll be there in the midst of the storms. Praise God.
Yeah.
And I was thinking there, you know, it may not be every day that, you know, we have everything. But, you know, he'd been tempted, you know, and he began to try to make Jesus doubt he was the Son of God. He knew he was. You know, back in the Old Testament, when Moses was there, had all the babies from 2 years old down, because, you know, the devil knew he was coming, but he didn't know when. And, you know, killed there. And Moses, you know, here he was saved, got drawn out of the water, and raised right up in there. And, you know, God had Moses, he's going to be the deliverer for Israel. And, you know, it said, you know, I was reading in there, he was one of the meekest men on earth. And I was reading what meek meant, and it meant one of the humble. You know, he could get down and cry out to God and say, "God, you know, I've got so many burdens on me. God, I don't know if I can make it." And he said, "Pick you out, I believe, 100 men. They will help you, Moses. Tell them and lead them and put them in charge of out of these 12 tribes of Israel. Put them in charge of them." And you and Aaron, he out here and he began to tell him, I tell you, Moses may have not been king, but I believe he was the first leader of Israel, king like a kingship. And I tell you, he didn't get to see the promise, I mean, to walk over in it, but he went up on the mountain and he looked over.
Yes.
God had something better for Moses.
Amen.
He had, you know, to walk down those streets of gold.
Yes.
"Moses, you have lived a hard life. Now welcome in, my son. I'm going to take you on into the promised land."
Praise
and that
God.
Promised land was heaven. Praise God. That's his promised land today. And the devil took him up. And Jesus said, you know, he said, "Command." You know, he knew he was hungry. You know, he was flesh. Jesus was just like us, even though he was the Son of God. And, you know, he got hungry, he got tired, he had to have sleep, he had to have all of this.
Come on, brother.
And, you know, he said, "Command these stones to me being bread." And he said, you know, Jesus answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeded out of mouth of God." Some people today think the Ten Commandments, where we don't have to live by the commandments anymore. They were back in Moses' day. You know, they used to put in some of these stores, they put the commandments up in the restaurant, and they said, people said, you know, "I looked and I saw those Ten Commandments there, and I was thinking about stealing something, and, you know, I thought, my God, you know, God's watching me, and they might catch me." And, you know, they used to put them up in school. Now, you can't even hardly mention the word of Jesus in schools anymore. I tell you, our nation better get back to God. I tell you, we're on the last leg today, and if we don't cry back out and get back to God, we're doomed.
Amen.
We went through 3 wars and ain't won on any of them. Korean War, we didn't win it. Vietnam, over in Afghanistan over like 20 years. God, United States used to be a nation. All of these other countries looked up to it. But I tell you anymore, they mock us and they, you know, they don't want anything to do with us.
Brother.
And all of that, they're not afraid of us because we we are not afraid of God, one reason.
Amen.
And the governor just the other day signed a bill that, you know, if they're having an abortion and the baby's born alive, they got to do everything in their power to save that baby's life.
Come
and
on,
some
brother.
Of these women said, oh, we don't like that. We're going to rebel against it. We don't want that baby. I tell you, if we don't get back to God,
yeah.
You know, I don't know how much longer God's patience is going to be there. I tell you, sometimes we need to get down there
yeah.
in that wilderness,
come
praise
on,
God,
brother.
And cry out to God.
Hallelujah.
He used to be, oh, let the pastor do it. He can pray. And when I first got saved, sure, he said, ain't you going to pray about it? And the pastor told me he was praying about it. Hey, it's good the pastor prays for us, but I tell you, we've got to get down a lot of time,
yeah.
most of the time,
oh,
and pray
yeah.
for ourselves and say, God, I'm the one that needs a standing in prayer today. I'm the one that needs a touch. Lift the pastor up. You know, lift him up. You don't know what he might be going through today, too.
Right, brother.
Praise God. He's not always up on the mountaintop.
Yeah.
And I have one pastor, and you know, he said he got, and I guess went and told the church what he was going through. And a couple of weeks, they called the overseer and said, well, he's going through all these problems himself. He, you know, well, you were to send us another pastor. How can he bear our burdens and all this when he's going through? You know, you're not going to always be up there. I tell you, a lot of times
brother.
The pastor may be
yeah.
dying, you know, going through this and that, but he can't go to the congregation. Because they say, well, he's weak, he's not praying the way he should be, or in this and that. But I tell you, he shouldn't have to ask us to lift him up in prayer. It should be a daily thing,
yes.
praise God,
amen.
To lift him and Sister Beverly up. It should be a very thing.
Yeah.
You know, like he said before, I know where each of you sit, and I'm praying for you because I know where you sit. How come we ensure he cleans the church? We come to him many times, and he's back there studying and reading the Word of God. That's the kind of man of God I want to be my pastor.
Amen.
Back there praying and reading the Word of God and crying out. Not out here on the golf field playing golf and out here running around. I tell you, if there were more pastors praying and, you know, studying the
yeah.
Word of God, they wouldn't be out here running around with
Amen.
The office sex and getting their stuff in trouble.
Amen.
Too many men of God is out here and chasing skirts around when they should be seeking
Come
God
on,
and crying out for God.
Amen.
I tell you, we need some men of God that's got some backbone and
yeah.
got some integrity about it and say, you know, I could have went out with many women
yeah.
where I worked, but I said no. And they said, you must be happily married. And I said, I sure am. And number two, I'm a godly man. And number three, God has called me to preach, and I ain't going to do anything. There's a few men to preach. So, you know, I got to can't use somebody to get out here and live like the devil. God needs a man that's out here living
yeah.
a righteous life. Praise God, that's what we
yeah.
need.
Amen.
No wonder there's no power
yeah.
in the house of God, because you don't have a whole lot of godly men anymore crying out. Somebody said, well, what do you think about a woman preacher? I said, well, some of them probably live closer to God than some of these men.
Yeah.
At least they ain't out here running around. Most of them ain't. They're probably praying and seeking God.
Come
and
on,
you
brother.
Know, and maybe God decided to call some of these
yeah.
women because you can't find no good men.
Amen.
Yeah. Come on.
That's what we need. It don't matter to me. I ain't going to try to tell God who he can use and who he can't. You know, we're saying, God, get off the throne.
Yeah.
You don't know what you're doing. No, God knows
yeah.
exactly what he's doing.
Amen.
Preach it, brother.
I used to thank my God. You know, I'm afraid I offend somebody. I don't care no more.
Yeah.
There's going to be souls down there in hell going to be saying, oh, why didn't you tell me the truth? Why didn't you say you can't do this and
yeah.
you can't do that?
Well, that's exciting.
When you go
yeah.
through the Ten Commandments, I tell you, it's just as real today as it was back
yes,
4,000 years ago. I tell you, we need to live by it.
Yeah.
Amen.
And he went on, and he said, I will give the glory then delivered to the youth to whoever I'll give. Verse 7. In Luke chapter 4, therefore, will worship me, it shall all be thine. Well, when Adam fell, Satan took charge of it. But you know, he didn't have full charge. God still had it. And you know, Jesus, when he died, he went down there and took the keys, death, hell, and the grave. He took the kingdom back.
Praise God.
He just ain't possessed it yet. He's coming back for a 1,000-year reign. Set his kingdom up. But Satan's only got him even back in the day of Job. He had to go to God and get permission what he could do and what he couldn't do. So today, brother, you're a child of God. Yeah. You know, devil can't come up on you and Brother Bill and put all of this on you. We need to take the authority that God has given us and say, listen, devil, I know what saith the word. I'm telling you today, according to the word of God, say, God is no respecter of persons, and get behind me, Satan, for I'm taking charge over you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
My Lord. I was reading there, you know, about Samuel talking about Eli.
Let them Lord.
And you know, he went out and so many got killed in battle. And his two sons was put up in charge over the people, you know, taking care of this and that.
Yeah.
And Eli was like 98 years old. And he'd given them authority, you know, to distribute to the widows and all of this and take charge of it. And they were out here, you know, running around these wild women and everything else. And you know, God had to speak to Samuel, a little old boy. And he said, called him. And he said, yes, he went to Eli and he said, did you call me? And he did that three times. And Eli said, you know, the next time, say, here I am, what do you want? Then he went back and he called him. Next, he didn't want to tell Eli what God had told him. And he said, you know, be truthful with me, tell me, and don't hold back. And he said, I want to know. And he began to tell him all about this. Said, the kingdom's going to be taken from you. And, you know, about his two sons and all of this.
Come on,
well, bro. They went back out. They went down and got the ark. And they brought it back. They thought, oh, we've got the ark. There's nobody can defeat us. And he went back out in battle, and 30,000, I believe, fell there, and one escaped and run back to Eli. And he said, you know, we've lost the battle. They got the ark. They took it back. Your two sons have been killed. The army's been wiped out. I tell you, that's what sin does. You know, one or two gets in there, like it can rock it back and hit it in the camp. And one or two gets in there, and we've got to deal with it. And and Eli listened. And he fell back. He was 98 years old, a heavy man, and broke his neck. And his daughter came up there, and she said, my husband's dead. And his brother's dead. My father-in-law's dead. And she had gave birth to a baby there. And they said, oh, the baby liveth. And he's got to talking with her, and she had died, and they named that baby Ichabod, which means the Spirit of God has departed. It's a sad thing when the Spirit of God departs from the house of God.
Yes, come on.
Or departs from one of God's service. It's a sad thing when, you know, and I tell you how many men of God out there have sold herself out for a few minutes of pleasure.
Come on, brother. Preach it, brother.
I tell you today, God is wanting some people there who live holy and got some backbone about it and saying, this is what saith the word of God. You know, like I said many times, the pastor preaches what God wants him to, and don't blame him, blame God. Like Jimmy Swaggart said one time, don't blame me if I get on your feet, because God told me to do it, and you go talk to God.
Amen.
Yeah. Preach it, brother.
If I could put a message, a title on this message today, we all have wilderness.
Yes, we do, brother.
We all go through battles. Yeah. We're not always up on the mountaintop.
Amen, brother.
And to get on that mountaintop, there's a valley down there.
Yeah.
And it does us good to stay down in that valley sometimes a little while. You know, there's a song out, Lord, don't remove this valley. Lord, don't let me be on the mountaintop. I tell you, it's down. I used to work, and I thought, Pastor, no, you work 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, for Well, you don't get out to the house of God, and you come home, you're dead tired, and you get up the next morning, you're tired, and this went on for 47 days. Some of them had worked a lot longer than that, probably, and when they were getting on each other's nerves, wanting to fight and everything else, arguing, and I thought, my God, what have I walked into? But he tell you, I could get down and pray and seek God and cry out, and God would give me peace in the midst of all
that. Amen, brother.
And I tell you, that's what we need today. Like the pastor said, we need the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Amen. You know, it's not all just shouting. It's not all speaking in tongues. But when you get there, when you've lost a loved one, and you say, God, I need some comfort in my life,
yeah,
he will comfort you in the midst of the storm.
Yes,
yeah, amen.
I went through quite a bit of death lately. My brothers and sisters, my mom and my dad, a lot of them, and a lot of them has been way younger than me.
Yeah.
But, you know, God has given me the strength to go through all of that.
Yeah.
My sister-in-law, she died about 3 weeks ago. I never dreamed. Used to sit right there. And we brought her to church and she wasn't feeling good. Then we'd got the COVID, so we didn't want to go around her. Next thing we know, she was tucked down to Middletown Hospital, and no visitors or nothing. Like Sherry said, we don't know when the death angel comes by our way. I was up there over at the emergency room, the 75, and I had fallen asleep sitting there, and I heard somebody shout, holler, and got and looked up, and I saw somebody laying in the floor out there. The doctor came out, and I don't know, about 7 or 8 of them had come out there, and they put her on this this plastic thing, and put her on a bed and tuck her in there. And they said, well, what'd your husband do? She said, he was out there. We saw somebody come up there and look, but he didn't seem to be too concerned. I thought, well, I didn't know who it was. But, you know, she was all right. And but, you know, it's just, we never know what we're going to do. I hope I've said something today would encourage you. So when you're going through a valley, or you're going through a battle, or just hang on.
Yeah.
God's going to bring, he's not going to leave you there.
No.
I tell you, don't be ashamed to ask for prayer.
Amen, brother.
You need prayer from God, somebody. Because God's got people here that know how to get a hold of God.
Amen.
And stuff. And that's what the house is. It's a filling station. Get you filled up, get you fired up, keep you fired up, praise God. And I tell you today, I hope I've said something today would encourage you.
Amen. Amen.